It's my pleasure to welcome you all to the last final session of our collaborative lecture series, Reframing Mass Violence. It's also a great pleasure to introduce my esteemed colleague and friend, Francisco Ferrandiz. And you may ask yourself, how is it that it's a Spaniard who has the last word on this collaborative? Well, it's not a coincidence, but a coincidence not of a theoretical nature or a personal choice. It is because when I approached Paco to invite him to this lecture series, he said, okay, but I'll go when it's nice and sunny outside and warm. So this is the best we could do. So that's why he's here in May. So let me introduce briefly Francisco Ferrandiz. He's a social anthropologist. He has a PhD from the University of Berkeley. He's a tenured scientist at the Spanish Research Council in Madrid. And he's a principal investigator of a research project titled The Past Beyond Ground, Memory Politics and Exhumations in Interdisciplinary Perspective, in Interdisciplinary and Comparative Perspective. Among his recent publications, Exhuming the Defeated, published last year in American Ethnologist, Rapid Response Ethnographies in Turbulent Times, which is an article published in a special issue on public anthropology in the journal Anthropology Today. And just 2 weeks ago, a book came out in Spain in the, by the publisher Anthropos, El Pasado Bajo Tierra, Exhumaciones Contemporáneas de la Guerra Civil. And with Anthony Robin, who was actually our first speaker within the lecture series last November, Francisco is editing a volume on exhumations as human rights tools in different countries across the world, which will be published by University of Pennsylvania Press by the end of the year. It's a great pleasure, Paco, to have you here. Please join me in welcoming Francisco Ferrandiz.
Well, thank you very much, Alex. It's not true that I just wanted to come here because of the sun, because we have a lot back home. But it's a total pleasure being here, and it's the second time I'm in this university presenting different stages of our research on exhumations in Spain. I would really like to thank the Institute for Advanced Study and the Human Rights Program with Barbara Fry, Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies with Alex Barrett, I mean, Ana Forcinito, for bringing me here. So I wanted to share with you some ideas about what is going on in contemporary Spain in relation to this exhumation process. Probably you know that in the last 14 years there have been like basically the grandsons of those who were defeated in the Civil War started to open up the graves with the bodies of those who have been shot in the repression, both during the war and in the post-war years. So this has created major debates in Spain, and I will be talking about this. But basically, and mostly, not to repeat myself with what I already exposed here a few years ago, I'm going to be mostly talking about how this Spanish memory politics is intersecting and hybridizing and mixing up with global memory processes and memory flows. So I will be reading the paper just in order to try to be as brief as possible. But I also have a number of slides, which I hope they help you ground the things I'm going to be talking about. And sometimes I will make some comments on the images, but the images are mostly for the debate. So if I don't say something about something concrete and you want to know what's going on in that picture, you can ask me later. So, okay. Francisco Franco's legacy of terror is being unearthed in contemporary Spain, more than 70 years after the Civil War and more than 30 years after his death. When the dictator passed away in 1975, institutions steadily transformed to meet democratic standards, letting aside past grievances and, most importantly, the Civil War and its aftermath of repression and suffering was a dominant plot amongst the main politicians and intellectuals of the time. The political right and left agreed to move forward and look for a future of reconciliation. an amnesty law was decreed in 1977, and a new post-dictatorial constitution was established. The civil war was had been definitely neutralized, and Franco's military regime overcome. Spain's transition became a political model for the smooth transit between bloody dictatorships and democratic regimes. For a couple of decades, Spain could even teach lessons to the world. Or not quite. Now, more than 30 years later, an emerging political culture in Spain, first led by the grandsons of the defeated generation, is questioning this commonsensical political narrative, as well as relevant aspects of the political and institutional architecture derived from it, protesting against the loss of memory and the impunity of Francoism. In the mid-70s, few questions were asked about the past, not to talk about the legal or moral responsibility for any of the crimes committed during the war and the early post-war years. In the process of building Spain, the conditions for Spain's future of peace and democracy, something extremely delicate had been left aside, namely the unmaking of crucial aspects of Franco's quite successful blood pedagogy, the ultimate heart of his fear politics, the black box of the massive rearguard repression. But you can see here just an image, one of the images we have of a shooting in Spain. It was the front page of a newspaper in Córdoba, and you can see they are about to be shot, so it's not so common to get these images. Well, okay, indeed, in the last 14 years, claims to justice and reparation by the diverse victims of Francoism have taken a sharp twist, dramatically bringing to the fore most uncomfortable evidence, defying the country to react to what was supposed to be the almost forgotten leftovers of a vanishing political cadaver. More concretely, I refer to the exhumation of the corpses of the defeated, as you can see in this image, mostly those of civilians executed in the rear guards by paramilitary groups connected to the Franco soldiers. Bodies inscribed with Franco's brand of fascism through mistreatment, torture, and executions. Bodies buried increasingly deeper into oblivion by consecutive layers of silence, shame, fear, and exclusion as the years passed by since the trigger was pulled. These corpses remain ignored for decades as a necessary price to pay for the definitive pacification and modernization of the country. Just to understand the scale of this rear guard killing, for those of you who don't know about it, historians calculate that probably 150,000 civilians were executed by Franco's mandate across the country. Of course, there was also Republican repression also in the rear guards, but it's different in qualitative and quantitative terms. To many, Spain, a salient member of the European Union, woke up to the 21st century in shock, coming to terms with the uncomfortable images of a country still crowded with decades-old mass graves. Let me first introduce a brief genealogy of world exhumations in Spain, which I believe is important to better understand what's happening today. While the contemporary process of digging up the graves of the defeated has puzzled many, and even there have been accusations of necrophilia, whatever, in the present many political debates, Spain has dedicated many efforts to exhuming, relocating, and memorializing the civil war death since the very conflict itself. As you can see in these images from 1939, where the widows of those who had been shot by the Republicans were mourning their bodies in a mass grave very close to Madrid, Paracuellos. These consecutive exhumations have had different fortune regarding the shifting position of the corpses being excavated within the nation-building process after the war, during the dictatorship, and later in democracy. As I said, ever since Franco's military victory, many deaths of those on the winning side were researched, located, unearthed, reinterred, and incorporated into memorials, commemorative cycles, and funerary projects accompanied by an uncompromising rhetoric of nation-building, sacrifice, heroism, and martyrdom, because you know Franco's regime was built, on religious terms as a crusade against the communists. Well, then, starting in the late 50s, I don't know if you know this building here, there was a new and staggering wave of exhumations linked to Franco's gigantic civil war memorial project. Bodies from across, this is the Valley of the Fallen, bodies from across Spain were unearthed in large numbers and reinterred here in this building, in this monument. During many years, a still under research administrative mortuary procedure brought more than 33,000 bodies to this monument. The now controversial memorial is presided, and you can see here one image of these bodies being pulled into the crypts and whatnot. This now controversial memorial is presided over by the graves of José Antonio Primo de Rivera, who in Spain could be like the founder of the Fascist Party, who was buried there in 1959, and then Franco, who was also buried in this building in 1975. And there's still, you know, like a daily masses in this building. Later, over the first few years of Spain's transition to democracy, groups of relatives opened a good number of Republican mass graves with little or no institutional or technical support. They had most, and you can see here, they are just digging with spades and taking the bones, but there is no forensic, nothing here in this place. They had mostly local profiles, and many of them were not even recorded or photographed, although some called some media attention. However, we think that they slowed a little bit in 1981 when there was a military coup, as you know, and Tejero just took the parliament here, as you can see him, and he shouted, everybody keep still. So I think that there was some fear growing in society that there could be another military coup in Spain. Let's move now to the most recent wave of exhumation, which has the year 2000 as the founding moment. This date refers to the opening of this mass grave in Piranza del Bierzo in León, containing 13 bodies. Since then, over 350 mass graves have been opened, totaling more than 6,500 bodies recovered. The mass graves of the defeated in the war suddenly changed from emotional and political wastelands into highly charged minefields available for public exposure and debate, setting in motion a complex memory process. As just outlined, this development needs to be understood. In local historical terms, but it also begs deep attention to broader and highly controversial debates related to the contemporary reconciliation of the Civil War as a traumatic past. In turn, these contemporary national controversies occur within the framework of comparable disputes elsewhere in the world regarding transitional justice, the flow of memory cultures in multiple formats, or the increasing relevance of victimhood politics in the transnational arena. But this is just one image of when activists on the ground start to look for the graves, and they use these maps, and they try to find the places where the mass graves are located. But sometimes it's very difficult because most of the people who knew where these mass graves were have already died because of the time frame, the time who has passed since then. So I'll say a few words about the possible conceptualization of mass graves as memory sites. Just a few words about it. This is not Spain, it's Kosovo. What happens when memorial practices intersect with mass graves and exhumations? What is it in mass graves under exposure that deeply condition and taint whatever memory processes unfold around them? I will briefly spell out five characteristics of the mass graves as memory scapes. One, mass graves related to human rights violations are more often than not parts of integrated topographies of death and terror. Their analysis is crucial to better understand the logic and symbolism of mass killing and genocide, as well as their after effects. Two, mass graves are especially delicate memory places as they become increasingly interwoven with the transnational spread of human rights cultures and practices. Three, a crucial attribute of mass graves and exhumations is the predominance of tissue, body, bone, and inflicted wounds in the reinterpretation of the past and what we might call a body-centered memory necropolitics attached to them. Fourth, as you can see in this image, this is the image of an exhumation which took place in the year 2004. Fourth, the prevalence of bones and potentially criminal evidence in mass graves engendered very, very specific and sophisticated biotechnologies for deciphering the past in the context of legal prosecution. The increasing predominance of forensic protocols in the management of exhumations establishes technical procedures and laboratory work as almost natural extensions of the mass graves and as an integral part of funerary practices. I will elaborate on this a little bit more later. Finally, just to briefly, because I need to talk about this. Another quality of mass graves as memory escapes concerns the kind of testimony and witnessing they elicit, equally attached to the very physical and overwhelming presence of corpses and skeletons. In the last decade, memory studies have developed a growing interest in what it's called by different authors, multidirectional memories, transnational and transcultural memories, global memoryscapes, or cosmopolitan memory cultures, overlapping theoretical frameworks to understand the globalization of memory. As the exhumations I am talking about started in the year 2000, whatever memory practices related to them are heavily influenced by global memory processes. So this is what I'm going to be talking about today. In fact, the Spanish case has been highly dynamic in incorporating to local memory practices and cultures bits and pieces of transnational memory processes in a number of ways. At the same time, I think that the impact of Spain's bones and is starting to be important also, is contributing to develop a global memorial pool related to past violence and atrocities. So what I see here is like that there is a double process of downloading, you know, of these global memory flows, but also there is a simultaneous uploading of the Spanish corpses into this global memory pool. This uploading of the Spanish memory bodies and the Francoist repression into the global pool of atrocities, I think it is also related to the iconic status of the Spanish Civil War, which responds to a variety of reasons, the extent to which it presaged the Second World War, the experimentation of new weapons and military tactics against civilians, the fact that it was one of the first wars with sophisticated international media coverage, including newspapers, photography, and film, or the presence of anti-fascist international brigades fighting for the Republic against their military oppression, as well as a picture of the survivors of the Aranjuezco brigade. In the Spanish exhumation case, transculturality or cultural hybridization is taking place mostly with memorial cultures traveling from Latin America. This is an important point to take into account, and particularly South Congo. But it equally absorbs in its making some European reference, as well as powerful global memory plots and technologies which affect other similar processes in Europe and elsewhere. So, in what follows, I will focus on three interrelated themes, hoping to provide three places in which the Spanish local memory processes are intersecting and mixing up and hybridizing with these global memory cultures and flows. I will first stop a bit on victimhood politics, more concretely on the progressive transformation in the last decade of those shot behind the front lines in the war from executed, which in Spanish is fusilados or paseados, or there are a number of local ways of referring to them, but basically executed, they are being transformed into disappear, which I think this is absolutely crucial in the transformation of victim politics. Here I will refer to the local recycling or vernacularization of global human rights discourses, practices, and iconographies within contemporary Spanish memorial culture. So here, of the three topics I will be talking about, these points refer to the circulation and blending of political cultures. Okay. Secondly, I will outline the consequences of the predominance of forensic aesthetic and scientific logics as one crucial memory plot in contemporary Spain. Here I focus on how an increasingly prestigious global, I mean, it's problematic, but nonetheless prestigious, global scientific technology transforms into a major memory narrative profoundly tainting a broader memory process. This refers to the reciprocal contamination between a professional culture and a cluster of local memories. I will try to explain why this is so particularly in Spain. This is mostly due to the lack of judicial coverage. Thus, in this case, I expose how a prestigious scientific culture has the potential to deeply condition and reframe a broader memory process. In third place, I will discuss the importance of digital technologies in the shaping of the historical memory of these 70-year-old crimes. Here I focus on how new digital technologies, devices, and online platforms profoundly imprint the production, circulation, and consumption of information and images of past atrocities. As you can see here, this is my mobile phone, and this is an image I got from, you know, Bluetooth, what I call Bluetooth ethnography. You know, there is one place and people just bring you and give you images or through WhatsApp. Or, I mean, this is a pretty interesting process. I mean, and this is based also in a joint research I started to carry with Alejandro Bay in this digital afterlife, as we call it. So let's start with the Spanish disappearance, forced disappearance. In Spain, the translation of transnational categories such as forced disappearances into the local jargon of historical memory has been taking place in the last few years within the framework of efforts to build a culture of rights for the Republican victims of Franco's military coup and dictatorship. Of course, as you can see here, basically this notion of the disappeared started to be more common in Spain by the 2005, 2006, 2007, particularly 2008. Before that, we people would bring to the cremation these images, you know, these family albums, in black and white albums, and they would talk about them, and it was very interesting. No? But then there was a major transformation. No? References to human rights violations were present since the very first cremation in the year 2000 and the birth of the new memorialistic movement. But the massive arrival of this terminology basically is related to this man, to the presence of this man and the judicial intervention of this man. Probably most of you know who he is, because he is Baltasar Garzón, who is well known for having indicted Pinochet quite a few years ago. So, to make a very long story short, because this is a huge topic and it's very complicated in legal terms, many associations and victims, frustrated by the mildness of a law of historical memory which was being drafted by the socialist government, then in power, filed reports and claims in Garzón's office starting in 2006, searching for a judicial way out to what they consider an institutional deadlock, so they couldn't get the government to recognize, you know, the rights of these victims. On October 16th, 2008, Judge Baltasar Garzón declared himself competent to judge the case against Francoism, and I'm quoting him here, mainly due to the existence of a systematic preconceived plan to eliminate political opponents by means of multiple deaths, torture, exile, and forced disappearances, illegal detentions of people starting in 1936. With the information provided by some associations, which this is what the associations talking to the press in front of Garzón's office in 2008 when this was happening, he listed a total of 214,266 such cases. We are talking about major numbers of possible disappearing. His harsh indictment of Francoism fueled an intense but really short-lived whirlwind in which legal technicalities were mixed up with political controversies and a significant media storm. It was really hard that the images of Franco appeared in the front pages. Is he a criminal? Is he not? For the first time. But four weeks later, under both friendly and enemy fire, he withdrew his indictment. but persisted in saying that he was right, he had no means to continue. Later, he was accused of malpractice and had to undergo trial in the Supreme Court. Although he was finally declared innocent, in the Francoist case, he was declared guilty. In another case, he was kicked out of the profession, so now he's doing other things because he's not anymore a judge. This is in Spanish, but I think it's easy to understand. Despite its legal failure, Garzón's judicial action was a major turning point in how the legacy of Franco's repressive regime was perceived, especially by the memorial movement located mostly on the social and political left. Then, since 2008, the notion of Franco's missing has proliferated in discourse, in the public arena, and has showed an very, very important mobilizing capacity. It didn't exist before in Spanish politics, it just came by then. No? This emerging category of victims correlates with other transnational modalities of crimes against humanity, filling the repressive machinery of Franco's repression with what military level, what we might call borrowed meaning. So when you frame your victims within as disappear, you are borrowing meaning from other disappears in other parts of the world. And this is especially important for the memorial associations that they can attach, you know, the suffering in Spain to the suffering of the victims in Latin America, Bosnia, and other places in the world. So many associations and collectives of victims quickly adopted bits and pieces, and this is the reason I use this concept of downloading, because downloading is, you know, is metaphorical, but it's also very, very practical. I mean, you just download a legal document and you reinterpret it within your memory movement, and there is this uploading, downloading process going all the time. So what I did is just, I just typed disappeared, forced disappeared in Google, and this is what you find. When I talk about the globalization of the category, you can see people from, you know, different places in the world, Spain, Latin America, Bosnia, East Asia, many other places. Okay, as this new category of victim rooted in the Spanish imaginary, the transnational iconography of the disappeared also started to proliferate in Spain. It was a new thing in Spain's public sphere. It was totally new. Increasingly displacing formally these formal images, black and white images of family albums I showed you before, which has this radical political and iconographic transformation of the victims of Francoism from executed to disappear gives full credit to Chilean playwright Ariel Dorfman, and this is one thing that Alex and I have quoted in a paper we wrote together. His statement that the pictures of the missing are already part of a widespread, almost epidemic image of tragedy and defiance that is just as much a part of our planetary imagination as the all-pervasive brands and logos, which obviously convey a very different sort of message. This was very evident, for example, in the May 24th, 2010 demonstration, which took place by the same time Garzón was being judged, the biggest public concentrations against the impunity of Francoism so far. And I will just give you an anecdote because Lisa remembers this very well. We had this conference here in Minneapolis on the very May 24th, 2010, and some of the activists who had organized this demonstration were here. They were very anxious because you know, we were here, but all their work was there. So through video streaming, we would be projecting the information and the demonstration real time, so we were talking about Spain and then we would have the demonstration. That was really funny and interesting.
Thank you for planning that for us.
Yeah, well, it's that with the golden visa, you have to make these things happen. Okay, so many in the political right felt truly uncomfortable with this development and blamed Garzón for further poisoning public debate in the country. We should remember, they said, this is the logic of the right in Spain, that Spain had already been reconciled and had decided to forget grievances during the transition to democracy. So what's the problem? That all parties had already agreed to an amnesty law that we should look to the future and not to the past, and that there was no point in reopening old wounds. Criticism and misgivings also came from some journalists and academic quarters on the political left, and that that was more shocking, but it's also interesting. Let me just briefly mention one example, which is, I think, an excellent thermometer of how deep this originally legal notion, like forced disappearance, have penetrated public discourse and of the local resistance to them also in the political left. So, prestigious and now deceased journalist Javier Pradera, very, very prestigious, wrote in 2008 a provocative editorial accusing the Garzón, Baltasar Garzón, of dipping into a hallucinogenic trip into the heart of darkness of the Civil War. Later, he constantly rejected the use of the category of the missing for the Spanish case, which he considered a deceitful copy or a bad translation of Latin American experience. Instead, he preferred vernacular, our Spanish kind of, you know, terms, which are more rooted in our tradition, you know, paseado, walked around, fusilado, shot, ejecutado, executed, whatnot. So, with this, Pradera, in León, you can see here, this is different the silhouettes of the disappeared, and this is the siluetazos. This also started to happen in Spain, but this is totally, completely new to Spanish political culture. These things that are actually, this Ponferrada in León, in the same place where the first exhumation took place. So they just take these images from Google, and they just do it on the ground, which is, I think, extremely interesting. So, let's go back to Pradera for a minute. So, with this argumentation, he was questioning what he called the false parallelisms between the two shores of the Atlantic in relation to political repression and his contemporary memory. Yet, he had already lost the battle, as the victims of Francoism have merged with the broader historical experience of forced disappearances. This may be questionable to many, but there's no way back. Even when intellectuals might object to it, even when the right might object to it, the notion of the disappearance is already very, very common. And it's interesting when you go to an exhumation, and in the first years of this exhumation process, people would talk to them as fusilados, and now, oh, here we find the disappeared. So there has been a really important transformation, which makes all the sense. No? So let's go to the second topic, the memory and the forensic, the importance of this second space of intersection, interaction, and interweaving of Spanish memorial processes and global memorial processes. This might seem a little strange to some of you, but Spanish exhumations are taking place in a legal limbo. There is no legal umbrella covering this exhumation. I know it's strange, but it's the way it is. The time passed since the crimes. This is the golden visa also. They have these special effects. So this is nothing. That's very just fireworks at the end. The time passed since the crimes. I mean, 70 years. That means that the statute of limitations has been covered for three times. No, added to the 1977. Amnesty law, and other legal impediments mean that there is no legal coverage whatsoever for exhumations, and they are not part of criminal cases. So here, to see an exhumation, there is a technical team, but if somebody goes there and picks up a bone, there's no authority saying, like, don't get that bone, why not? This is just, you know, like a stone. They are completely out of the legal system. In this framework, the development of technical protocols for the diggings has been crucial in the increasing importance of an archaeological and more specifically forensic regime of truth and aesthetics in the management of exhumations and as a consequence in the overall construction of historical memory in the country. The predominance of scientific methods has contributed to the spreading of a body-centered regime of memory, justice and truth searching established through the overwhelming flow of exhumed skeletons into the media and to the public sphere in the last decade. I think this is totally connected to this forensic thing. I mean, they do bodies, and then what they show and give back to society are wounded bodies, and this has completely transformed the way in which we think about the Civil War. We'll try to spell it out as briefly as possible. This corporeal epistemology resonates with what I'm quoting here, a friend of mine, Eric Klinberg, who is at NYU, resonates with what he calls an axiomatic principle of human rights workers and truth commissions throughout the world, namely the transnational consolidation of dead bodies as the site and surface of essential but otherwise obscure social truths. So you can see more or less the environment about that information. So, albeit lacking judicial sanction, this modality of human rights violation knowledge production is based on rigorous methodology, evidentiary logic, scientific, not legal, as I said, contemporary forms of technical and digital imaging, scientific custody, electronic archive building, and the growing use of DNA identification. But beyond these technical considerations, the scientific approach to opening and interpreting mass graves has gained considerable social prestige, and this is clearly linked to what some authors call the CSI effect, you know, like the fact that we all know more or less, I mean, these programs are very fantastic. So sometimes, but even old people approach the mass grave and say, oh, secure the perimeter, or, you know, they use this expression from this program, so DNA, are you going to take DNA? So they make up, you know, it's popular culture, but they call it the CSI effect, but obviously it gives a lot of prestige to the forensics. And when I say I'm a social anthropologist, nobody talks to me, but to a forensic doctor, everybody is like, God. So this is pretty interesting. This is obviously a huge issue. I'm just tiptoeing over here. Let me spell out in bullet points how the technical, forensic, and archaeological protocols and knowledge building both condition and become embedded in a very dynamic way in broader memorial, mourning, and funerary practices, creating novel amalgams. New rituals, memorial rituals, and funerary rituals. This obviously sets this 21st century exhumations apart from the transition exhumations that I talked to you about. This is another example. Here there is no forensic nothing. This is just a pile of bones with no identification or anything. This is 1977 in the village next to here. Well, a first aspect I want to talk about is the decisive impact of technical setups and aesthetics in excavations in memory building processes. Relatives, journalists, and onlookers alike experience the exhumations firsthand through the protocols established by archaeologists and particularly forensic doctors on the ground. This scientific memory recovery scenography, because this is a scenography, very, very recognizable, includes the careful and detailed exhumation adapted to scientific, not emotional or political needs, the individualization and numbering of bodies, the identification of personal objects with painted arrows and colored pins, the technical photographing and video recording of the whole process, etc., etc. Bodies are progressively transformed into scientific evidence as the excavation goes on, and are finally referenced and orderly lifted from the mass grave, stored in plastic bags and cardboard boxes, ready to be sent to laboratory for cleaning and identification procedures. So this is second. This is our forensic friend, Francisco Echeverria. Memory building in exhumations is heavily influenced by how scientific knowledge is transmitted to relatives on the spot in teachings. This is every afternoon or when they finish the exhumation. There is no authority here. No, anybody can attend an exhumation. Hang around for hours. You know, take pictures. There's no legal authority saying, no, this is under criminal case. You can, it's just whatever. So what they do is like they explain what happened during the day. So many of the people who are here are relatives of those who are being exhumed. So, and they learn about their relatives. They say, because they, when they talk, you know, while here you can see these people has a ballet wound, they had a coup de grace, or they have this bone is broken, and blah, blah, blah. So they talk in forensic terms about what's going on. So this is very, very, a way in which forensic knowledge becomes increasingly an important part of memory building processes. No? This is another, I haven't only seen this a number of times, it's not very common, but this is basically that people from the technical teams, but mostly relatives, once the grave is empty, they are brought back to the they are given the opportunity of occupying the space of the bodies, and this is very forensic construction, because the forensic doctor, they have these anatomical maps in computers, and they would say, no, your leg here, just twist your arm, and your ankle is here, but just your head goes in. So that they are just set in the yeah, this deserves, this image deserves this thing. So. So I just as a proposal, because I have no idea. This is just the forensic doctor we work with. He's very keen on inventing memorial people. He has invented a new one now. He has wrote me an email. So you are a genius. But this one, he invented it. So I don't know where it comes from, but it might have some connections to the siluetazos in Argentina. I don't know. I just found this image in the internet, and I saw that there were some connections between these two performances of, you know, occupying the space of the missing body. But I think this is pretty...
Who proposed it? I mean, who has the initiative?
Who is the idea?
Chivalry.
The forensic doctor.
Then DNA technology has deeply revolutionized the forensic field, as you probably know, and this is especially the case in Bosnia and whatnot. Transforming biological identification into a fetish. And it's responsible for new cultures and politics of identification, memory, and reparation. So in Spain, the arrival of DNA in 2006, particularly in 2006, has been very important, because at first, the bodies who were exhumed were re-inhumed in the what you might call the community of death. They died together, they should be reburied together. When DNA comes into the picture, people want their bodies to go to a particular private pantheon. So, if this is a clear case, I mean, there are many others. It's just throwing you some ideas here. This is a very clear case of how a forensic procedure can transform the way in which a memory building process is taking place. So now people is demanding particular bodies. Not this community of death from the beginning of the movement has vanished So another way in which this is scientific knowledge is openly deployed in forensic in reburial ceremonies and other memorial acts. Also, at first there were no, for example, this is the return. The bodies here have been returned in a village in the center south of Spain. You can see here the bodies of the seven peasants who had been killed in 1941. And you see here the forensic doctor. This is a ceremony, a commemorative ceremony. But the central part of the commemorative ceremony is the forensic doctor shown in pictures. This is a picture I showed you before. This is the image of the pyramid excavation. So that they are just showing images with, the forensic report is just displayed on the PowerPoint. So this is becoming part. You have all here all the politicians who later were returning the bodies. So you have the politicians. But the most important part of this ritual is the talk by the forensic doctor. No? For example, this we found in some exhumations, which the bodies are being returned to relatives with what on top of it? The forensic report. So they go to the cemetery, and this is what they start to peruse, the forensic reports in the cemetery. So they are, this is a forensic report open, broadly open. So this is what they are basically. So just imagine, no? In the ritual is a forensic ritual. I mean, the ritual practices are increasingly becoming an integral part of all of this, and I find this pretty interesting. And then there is another final twist to it. This is associations in civil society increasingly deploy scientific materials and derivatives in their own memorial acts, borrowing prestige from the forensic practice for the political cause and social. For example, this is a life-size image of an exhumation with more than 20 bodies. Which was taken by the forensic doctor, and then the association asked for the picture, which is real size. And so this picture has been in front of the Supreme Court, just denouncing the crash against Francoism. This is the Plaza del Sol Square, the central plaza in Madrid, with images of the disappearance around it. So you can see here that both the first two topics I was talking about, disappearance and forensics, coming together in this in a commemorative ritual in the center of Madrid, in the very, very center of Madrid. Okay. So, in sum, my interest in this section has been highlighting how science deployment in all phases of the exhumation process, not just as a technology, but also as an aesthetic, as an art of persuasion, as a memory building practice, and as a funerary ritual, has become a preeminent dignifying and reparation tool, both merging with, coloring, and displacing other available commemorative and dignifying social and ritual plots, which are related to Catholicism or to political cultures, which were there before. So just very briefly talk about this digital memory thing, which I think is something that Alex and I are working on as of today. No? This is, sorry for the publicity, this is the cover of my book, but it has to do with the black and white colors. Let's briefly move to the impact of these digital technologies. In the framework of what an anthropologist called Jeff Juris, he has worked with anti-globalization movements and the display, online display of these social movements, he has labeled the cultural logic of networking. To account for the sudden transit of some Civil War bodies from forgotten graves into the Spanish and even global public sphere, we have first to establish the radical anachronism or disjuncture between the terror machinery which produced them and the ways in which they have been exposed, absorbed into and recycled in the society of knowledge and information. I think this is crucial, and this refers to this image in which the black and white refers to the Civil War, which and the color refers to the color Spain, which is recovering the black and white Spain. So I think this is important, and particularly when you think that this color is becoming increasingly digital. No? Particularly after the first decade of the 21st century, the arrival and broader accessibility of digital technologies has deeply influenced the Civil War memory building processes, and I think it has done the same with most memory processes across the world. You know, the availability of smartphones has totally transformed the ways in which memory is being produced, circulated, consumed, recycled. It's a new world. We have to learn. There's a lot of research going on this, but we still have to understand exactly what's happening. So I think that in terms of the memorialist movement, which is a crucial force behind this movement, there is a growing confluence between what the Juris calls networks as computer-supported infrastructure. Here we're talking about technologies. Networks as organizational structures, which would be the form, and also networks as a political model, mediated by concrete activist practice. In the Spanish case, the speed in which traditional family black and white albums and the associated social context of memory sharing and circulation have given way to the predominance of a mostly digital memory scape is staggering. It's been like almost overnight. After the 5 years of exhumations, in a very short period of time, images and bits of information regarding the diggings, and you can see, I said before that anybody can go there and take a picture, so it's very complex then to control these images or to contextualize or to prevent the contextualization. It's impossible to do that. No? So these images and bits of information regarding the diggings started to become integral part of blogs. This is the main memory association. PowerPoints, webs, Facebook, Flickr, YouTube, and others. This is a tweet that I just captured, you know, 2 weeks ago, just going around. So who are these bodies? Nobody knows. Who are these people, where they were shot, who they recovered them, no idea. But they are circulating in Twitter, and they are being tweeted all over the world. The multiplication and diversification brought about by digital memory contributed to create new forms of authenticity and authorship in new ways of experiencing the past, with a clear risk of memory overload, which I think what's happening as of today. The potential instant accessibility of content and images in real time has also created new forms of witnessing, new subjectivities, new political identities, new mourning and commemorative practices, and new sites for emerging multidimensional memories. It also brings memory building closer to the media spectacle, which I think is deeply problematic, and also open multiple and dynamic uploading, downloading memory loops. Alex, I'm fine. Okay, so let's continue a little bit. So in Google Plus, again, you know, some people just upload images and then they send a link and then you can access them, but you don't know what's happening there. This in relation to the creative potential available to digital technology memory brokers. Power at your fingertips, basically. I'll go here with the iPhone. Yes, simply this image. But as I suggested, there is another angle to it, which I haven't worked so much on that, but I just wanted to discuss it with you later. Going deeper into issues of authorship and potential avenues of transculturality in digital memory processes also requires, or will require, or is requiring, to explore the specific ways in which evolving technologies condition digital memory. It's not just that we have the technology and can, but we are conditioned by the technology used to produce these images. As digital devices and social networking services proliferate, these new equipment and platforms are constructing new avenues for expression and circulation of historical memory, and new genres, new iconographies, and styles of imaging, in which the past is being constantly recycled. Social networks provide very recognizable and restrictive templates for the exposure of different kinds of memorial materials. To see here, I'll just go back to see one of so this is just Facebook. In Facebook, for example, when I talk about this, I refer that here I'm talking with Emilio Silva, for example, and I'm here talking with him, then you have publicity here, then the very structure of Facebook allows you to set up the images in a certain way, so this is what I'm talking about. It's not just that you have the technology, but the technology is also providing new ways in which to understand this. So if proliferation, decentering, manipulation, promiscuity, and the contextualization are some obvious consequences, it is also fair to emphasize the extent to which technology developers and social network designers, and more generally, corporate decisions taken in rather competitive market environment leave a decisive imprint in whatever social relationships and memory products and flows emerge with them. So I'm saying that who is the author of these new memories? Is it the activist taking the images, or if you have a Samsung mobile phone, the technology you, I mean, the kind of Zoom, I mean, if you are in G4 and G3, and the technology you conditions completely the quality of the image, what you can do with that, and also the social networks condition the way in which it's displayed. So I think this is extremely important in terms of thinking about digital memory. So should we incorporate into our analysis concepts such as Samsung or Nokia memories, or Facebook and Twitter memories? They might have an entity of their own. So, I'm just going to finish. So can we can. So, this is where Spain stands now. In the midst of a heated debate about the civil war, the long dictatorship, and the depth of their legacy of militarism, the opening of the mass graves of the defeated is proving to be a decisive tool of historical, political, and emotional unlearning of Francoism, but at the same time, it is also a testimony to the endurance of its foundation and the efficacy of its terror machinery. Here, this is a performance by artist, by a Spanish artist, which, you know, for example, welcoming out Franco's head and Spain still drinking from this well, so to speak. No? This demilitarization of Spanish society through exhumation practices is forcing the country to travel as deep as the physical wounds in which where it was inscribed in the executed bodies. And then it forces the country to critically follow back the corpses' afterlives from deep emotions to cyberspace, from artistic proposals to judicial resolutions, from political laws to grassroots commemorations, from local dynamics within families or villages to transnational processes. After 14 years of busy afterlife, as disappear in forensic formats, going digital, the exhumed bodies of the Civil War defeated are becoming crucial actors in the final dismantling of a decaying but still influential political corps. The tensions provoked by the uncontrollable flooding into civil society, the judicial system, political agenda, digital formats, media circuits, emotional regimes, or the country's historical consciousness are bound to extinguish the agonic breath of a vanishing regime, which in some senses has outlived its final conclusion, and it's only starting to lose its claim to impunity. Far from being a necrophilia anecdote, the comeback of the executed corpses of the defeated is not just history of Spain, but also history of the world, increasingly claiming a significant slot in the universal catalogue of cruelty and extensive human rights violations. So I'll stop here for now, and then we can just have a discussion.